They've won Tonys and Oscars and Emmys and Grammys. There's no red carpet because they're home in their jammies. From Melrose Place to Broadway to Janeway and her crew. Let Seth and James bring all the stars to you.
Anywho,
they're entertaining everyone, so who's gonna grouse? Just sit right back and you'll hear some tales on Stars in the
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Stars in the House.
Hello, everyone. I'm Seth Rudetsky, and this is James Wesley. And James is wearing the nice shirt that Paul and Steven got, right?
I am. My birthday gift this year.
So cute. We are a fundraiser for the Actors Fund, and we've been doing this since everything shut the hell down in March 2020. And the Actors Fund is specifically for Broadway actors for their second homes to keep them furnished. Okay, so yeah, it's not just for actors, it is for everybody in show business. Yes. So actors, singer, dancers, everybody backstage, literally anyone backstage, anybody front of house, anyone who works professionally in theater, TV, film, ballet, the arts. And right. Not just in New York City, also in Queens. No, literally across the country. Anywhere across the country. If you know anyone that needs any kind of help paying their rent or paying their medical bills,
go to ActorsFund.
ActorsFund.org. There you go. Go to actorsfund.org. But how the hell can people help these poor struggling artists?
Well, they can help by going to starsinthehouse.com and donating to the Actors Fund or texting to Fund 2020 or Fund 2020 to 56512. And if you want Tom Kitt or Heidi Blickenstaff or Pearl Sun to read your donation aloud, send it to donations@starsinthehouse.com.
Maybe Tom will set it to music. That's what he does. He takes lyrics randomly sent and simply puts a melody to them. Tom, start working.
We're up two, by the way, because I just asked you, because I wasn't here yesterday.
Yeah, I didn't read the total yesterday.
Because I was on my way to pick up Julie from the airport. I made that girl do a rapid test before she could take off her mask.
Rapid COVID test, not like biology.
Yeah, rapid COVID test. Yeah, I actually tested her on what she had done in Denver for the 10 days. That was the rapid test. No, it was for COVID. Because she's going to school in a couple of days, but her friend that she's had since she was in middle school, she lives in Denver now. And
Annabelle.
I wasn't actually going to say the name, so now I'm not going to tell the story.
Oh, I was so excited. Like, she's credit.
Well, now I can't say. That's okay. We don't plan this. No, it's because let's just say where she works. No. They are not following COVID protocol. And so that's all. I won't say anymore. I won't tell the whole story now that her name is out there because of social media. But that's right. Okay. We don't plan these things. So go ahead.
Speaking of COVID protocol, are we telling the movie story?
Well, I think we need to wait for LaPook for that because there's, you know.
We have just remind us to tell the story about what happened today.
Yeah, as we're preparing because we're moving. Because what I was going to say was Julie got home last night. We're packing her today. She goes to school on Friday. And then we're moving back to the city on Tuesday. So we're trying to
and by the way, I leave for Provincetown Friday. So I'm out here Saturday, Sunday, Monday. I fly in Tuesday to Manhattan when we're moving.
Yeah. So I'm doing this side here and then Seth's gonna be on the other
with my friend Paul Castry.
Yes.
I want to say one thing, and I knew as a Stars in the House person. So you know, we were supposed to do a big Stars in the House event September 12th, which now got pushed to October 30th, but instead I'm starting this new off-Broadway show.
It's been pushed to October 25th.
October 25th, sorry. June 30th was the first one. Anyway, I'm doing the show off Broadway at Asylum 212. That's really going to start running in October, but I'm doing like a one-day preview of it on September 12th, just because I know there are people flying in that wanted to fly in to see the... Anyway, we didn't even really put tickets on sale. We did like a soft launch, and I saw that two tickets were sold, and literally, look, Susan, I can't believe... Susan, they weren't even officially... We just sort of had the website up. I can't believe you got tickets already. So I think the website is like Asylum 212. I'll make a big deal about it. I think it's Asylum 212. No, Asylum NYC. But anyway, you can get tickets, I guess. I didn't know they were really available. Thank you, Suze.
Okay.
What else?
We are up to $1,059,590 raised for the Actors Fund. That is the latest total from Maggie at the Actors Fund. Wait, so I just wanted to say that. Yes.
I agree. Camera's hilarious because I was looking at the camera. I'm literally playing to the balcony. Oh. It's hilarious. How much again?
$1,059,590. Yes. Let's say, because I'm going to forget later. So tomorrow... Since tomorrow's Julie's last night, that's going to be tomorrow in our house. Yeah, not last night alive. I hope not. I figured everyone knew since I'd already said about school. So last night here, we're going to be honoring Julie. And I know we've got some wonderful viewers who love her too. And I'm sure we'll donate in her name to the Actors Fund. And we've got all sorts of videos. We watched some of them last night that Julie herself had not seen and Seth had not seen of when, because Julie came and lived with me as a baby when she was 5 months old, back in 2001. And the story goes from there. So there were things that Julie had not seen and Seth had not seen. So we're going to show some of those. And then you and Julie have been making videos together for years. So we're going to show some of those.
Pre-TikTok.
Yes, pre-TikTok. You made your own before there was TikTok. So we're going to do that. And we're going to have a few guests that are going to be joining us. And then Friday and Saturday, co-hosting with Anika Larson again. And Jack Plotnick will be here. And Pearl's going to be here. I forget. I don't have it right in front of me because, like I said, we've been between everything. You want to say who the guests are? Because we've got them.
It's for
Friday
game night.
And Saturday night for game night. It's going to be a lot of great people. I know Seth is jealous that he's not going to be able to play, but Pav.
Should I tell you who they are?
Yeah, do it right now.
Friday night is, as you said, Pearl's son, Carolee Carmello, the hilarious Kate Flannery, and a special Stars in the House viewer who we love, who just sent us the most stunning thing today, Ryan Rosenberg.
Yes, Ryan Rosenberg.
And then Saturday is Tanika Gibson, and we're going to be showing this incredible video of her. She just did Sound of Music out of Muni.
Yeah, she was in Ain't Too Proud before everything shut down.
Max Crumb. From Disaster on Broadway and also Grease. Yep. Jill Whelan from your favorite show.
Yeah, Love Boat.
Love Boat. And Anika's onstage husband, Jared Spector from
yes.
Beautiful.
They're going to be here on Saturday. And then next week, we've got Ruthie is guest hosting because that is our move day. We're like, we can't really.
Ruthie Fearbug is,
yeah, is going to be. I don't know what she's got planned. And then, you know, we can go ahead and say it right now because sure. We've got two amazing matches that are next week. We've got Dog Fight. That's going to be who's going to be joining? Because you booked that.
Well,
with
definitely
Lindsay
the
Mendez.
Two stars, Lindsay Mendez and Derek Klena.
Yep. So they're going to be here on Wednesday and Thursday. We have it just happened that it seems like we planned it because that's the first performance of Waitress on September 2nd. But we're not that good. So, but it just happened to be that we're going to have Jenna's from Waitress that mm-hmm. night. Jesse Mueller, of course, Nicolette Robinson. Who else? Shoshana Bean.
And Betsy.
Oh, and Betsy Wolf, right?
Yeah. So we're going to have a Jenna celebration as Jenna's on Broadway. We're going to have the Jenna's here. So
that's right. And I think another game night on Friday and then Saturday next week, because it's Labor Day weekend, we're not going to be doing it.
And
show.
We got another amazing match. Maybe we can't announce it yet, but.
You know what? I think if you want, you can say what's in the works.
It's I just mean there's a fan that not only donated to do game night, but he got a matching donation from his work.
Oh, that's something else. Yeah, so we'll discuss that another time. So.
Okay, but it's a lot of money coming in.
I know. So let's bring on the reason why we're here right now. Seth, you want to introduce Mr. Kitt?
He's the whole kit and caboodle. Where's the funny part?
Wow, I should have done the intro.
So horrible. Please welcome the multi-talented Thomas Kitt.
Hi, Tom.
Oh, Thomas, my parents will be so happy, Seth. I'm so happy to hear me called.
What's the full name? Thomas Matthew Kitt?
Thomas Robert Kitt.
I knew it was something literal happening.
So Tom, we're here. We're going to talk about Reflect. We have so much to talk about. And Pearl and Heidi are just two of many amazing people that are on there with you. But we got to first talk about New York State of Mind.
Yeah.
How did that all come about? If you haven't seen the video, we have the video. We'll play it.
I think we should.
You want to end the show with it?
I think so, because it's so comprehensively amazing.
All right, but how did it come about?
Well, last summer I joined an organization called NYC Next, and it was basically formed to combat all of the negative press coming out of New York. People saying it's over, it's done, you know, it's never coming back.
Gone.
And we wanted to create positive energy in the city as a way to show people the arts are alive and well, and also to hopefully motivate people to get involved, to donate. The Actors Fund is on the website that we are steering people towards. So that number is amazing, by the way. Congratulations. It's
thanks, Tom.
Unbelievable what you have done. So the first thing that we did, or that I was involved with, was a big pop-up event last October where we did Sunday on the steps with Broadway Inspirational Voices. Michael McElroy and I put that together. And then we met in December and said, well, what can we do next? And I said, well, we should do a song. And then I thought, why not do New York State of Mind, which was written in the 1970s, in another challenging moment for New York City. Billy Joel wrote it when people were fleeing and leaving New York. And he said, no, I'm coming back. Mm. And it's always been a song. It's been an anthem for New York's resilience and beauty and why people love it. And we were originally going to do it for February, for Valentine's Day. So this was really, this idea came about before vaccines, before, you know, figuring out how are we going to film this? How are we going to make sure we do it safely and according to protocols? And it sort of got pushed to the summer, which was great because now it gets to be in the world at this time when live entertainment is coming back. And from what I've gotten from people who have seen it, it's really been needed energy and hope and comfort and excitement about New York City. And so it's just become this thing, thankfully. And I'm just very proud of it.
I know you can't, you know, you can't pick your, it's hard to choose your baby, but is there one particular musical phrase that was sung that you were like obsessed with? Because I could think of ours from like Georgia and from, you know, there's always one particular one that I'm obsessed with. What's like the one that you were like, oh my God, that was a great choice?
You mean the performer and line in the...
Yeah.
That's, you know, that's a, you'd imagine that's a hard question because I love it all. But here's the thing, here's a moment that I will say I love the most in the video, or I should say one of the things that really moves me.
Yeah.
It's the opening when the brilliant Joseph Joubert, who plays piano on the track, he takes a breath just before the main melody begins and the camera cuts this beautiful footage of Coney Island. And it's just that moment of the pianist sort of putting everything in motion, because I scripted this out in the beginning and I thought this is sort of waking up in New York. This is a pianist begins to play and all around the city, we hear that and we feel that, and it's musicians in this moment of isolation, all being able to perform together. And it starts in Birdland with Joseph. So when that moment happens and he kind of makes everything start to happen in motion, I cried the first time I saw it.
Okay, well, you know what? We have to play it now. I know Seth was like, let's play it now. We got to play it now. We're going to play it, and then we're going to bring on Heidi. Okay.
Folks like to get away, take a holiday from the neighborhood. Hop a flight to Miami Beach or to Hollywood.
I'm taking a Greyhound on the Hudson River line.
I'm in a New York state of mind.
I've seen all the movie stars in their fancy cars and their limousines.
I've been high in the Rockies under the evergreens.
Under the evergreens.
But I know what I'm needing and I don't want to waste more time. More time. I'm in a New York state of mind.
So easy living day by day, yeah.
Out of touch with the rhythm and blues.
But now I need a little give and take. The New York Times, the Daily News.
Oh,
then New York Times, then Daily News. It comes down to reality,
and that's fine with me, cause I love it slide.
Hi, this is Ben Stiller.
That is so amazing.
Thank you.
Can't help but get teary-eyed. Tom, I watched that and it's like, you know, all the different things, amazing things and people specifically who Seth and I have worked with, we still feel like we'll say almost every day, can you believe that we've worked with this person or that person, especially if it's someone that's from our childhood or youth. What is your feeling when you work with these kind of people? Like, have you had that experience too? I'm sure you have.
Absolutely. First of all, it's just everyone was so genuine and giving of their time, and everyone is so passionate for this city that we call home. And so many of us have been here the entire time through this challenging moment. And talking about the video, it was, you know, we're still going through it, obviously. This is still, you know, you were just talking about it, all the challenges that are coming from this. So as much as for me, I would love to be like, hey, buy a ticket, everything's great. We're still going through this. And what I really wanted to speak to in this moment was the grit and the belief and the resilience of this city, and knowing that it's going to take all of us to put all of our energy, all of our activism, you know, to volunteer, to give of our time, as every artist who was a part of this did. And so just that alone makes me feel so grateful to be a part of this community. But of course you look around and say, I mean, I've been a fan of this person for my entire life. you know, and of course having Mark Rivera, Billy Joel's saxophonist, play on the track, Billy Joel's daughter, Alexa Rajel, you know, making it extra special to have Billy Joel's world, David Rosen, his musical director, you know, who helped produce the track with me and Scott Risette, and just on and on in terms of the people who gave to make this what it is, and everyone at NYC Next. It's like the longest press release ever because there were so many people that gave up their time to make this happen. So
yeah, our own Blake Ross, we know, was also a part of it. So
yes.
Great job, Blake. I'm proud of you.
And don't forget Blake's new podcast, Burnt, B-U-R-N-T, about the making of Rebecca the Musical, which never actually made it to Broadway. It's amazing. I'm obsessed with it.
Go, Blake.
All right, so Tom, let's talk about this new project.
Yeah, tell us about Reflect, and we'll bring out Heidi, Blickenstaff.
Isn't it from the song Mulan? Who is a girl?
actually, the album's title comes from a quote that Pearl Sun shared with me, which is this great Nina Simone quote that it's the duty of the artist to reflect the times that they're in. And this was a project that came out of a moment where I was struggling to create those first few months living here in New York City. One of the songs on the album called This Too Shall Pass talks about that time very specifically. And I'm sure a lot of artists can relate to this, that there was just, it was really hard to feel inspired and to get into your creative space. And then I was talking with my wife, Rita, and she said, no, this is a time that artists have to be speaking out and have to be doing things and have to be inspiring and bringing hope and reflecting these times that we're in. So the album was born there just to say, well, I want to speak this time, but I know that it's going, it needs to be collaborative. It needs to be pulling in so many emotions and feelings and themes. And because as we've heard this quote a lot, we're all boats in a storm, but you know, we're on different boats and we're going through something that can only be specific to us. And so I reached out to friends and I said, please send me in any form, you know, in a essay, a poem, lyric, something you want to express in song. And then I'll take that and create music and present you with the song. And if you feel good about it, then let's record it and make an album.
Oh my gosh.
And it actually worked.
Yes. Thank you. I mean, you've listened to it. So for you saying that, that means a lot. I mean, I feel very proud of it. And it's honestly one of the most personal things I've ever created.
Let's bring on one of your collaborators. She played the role of Heidi in Title of Show. And weirdly, in real life, she's named Heidi. Please welcome Heidi Blickenstaff. Hi, Hides.
Hi. How are you guys doing?
All good in the hood. Hi, Hides. How you doing?
I'm good. I'm happy to see you all. I'm in the same boat as you with losing a kid to college. So I feel you. I'm not moving right now. So you're winning in that department. But.
Okay.
But we just dropped off my stepson at Rhodes College in Memphis, Tennessee. And I'm literally right now in his bedroom. He left and 5 seconds later, I reclaimed it as my office. Welcome, bye.
Wait, did you like move in your Peloton or something obnoxious?
No, well, my Peloton is still in my husband's office where my office used to also be. But when Malcolm left town, I was like, I need my own space.
There you go.
So Nicholas has the Peloton and I have the guest bed and the office and the dog is with me right now too.
An angel.
So Heidi, tell us about Tom's email or call to you that was like, join me on Reflect.
Yeah, Tom and I had talked a couple of times during the pandemic and we were both feeling equally, you know, Tom, I never want to speak for you. You always have the perfect thing to say, but I think we were both feeling pretty lost and wondering where creativity was going to ever come from again. And Tom shared this idea about his album with me. And Tom's one of those people in my life, and I think a lot of us who are lucky enough to work with Tom, when Tom asks you to do something, it's like an immediate yes. You're just so happy to collaborate with someone like Tom, who is just so, you know, nobody's like Tom. And I feel something symbiotic with him as an artist. And so when he asked me to do this, I was absolutely thrilled to do it. And we threw around some ideas about how we had both been feeling. And Tom said, I have a song, I think, that already existed from another project that didn't move forward, but he had already written a song and he played it for me. And I immediately had a very strong emotional reaction to it. And we continued to talk about the song. And it was, other than a few kind of dramatic details, the song could not have expressed more succinctly exactly what I was feeling, which was, like, am I ever going to perform again? How does performing define my identity? Mm-hmm. When will we all be together again? I felt like being, everything that was also culturally happening in our world, all of that turmoil, I felt, I just wasn't sure I was ever going to be of use again on stage. I think we've all been going through some pretty deep thoughts. And this song so perfectly captured it. It was a song that Tom had written several years ago. And it's called I Need Them to See Me. And I heard it and I was like, let's do that.
Well, okay, we have the video, so we're going to show that. You know, but you know what's making me think, Heidi? It's interesting because you're talking about, and Tom, both of you, your conversation, and a lot of people were going through that. Not to make this about us, but you're actually helping us, actually, because what you were going through in the beginning, because we were doing two shows a day, every single day, we weren't experiencing that because we were just like, right, we're in crisis mode. But interestingly, that's the mode that Seth and I have been in the last several weeks as we're transitioning to do the show on Mondays and Tuesdays, because we're still going to do it. And Julie's moving out and we're going back to the city. It's like, who are we as artists? You know, I mean, it's like, what do we do? We're kind of where everyone, we feel a little bit behind because we're like, oh my God, we're like where everyone else was 18 months ago.
Yeah.
We may be calling you for help is what I'm saying. You and emotional
just
support.
Just get Tom Kitt to write you a song and you'll be fine. You can express yourselves that way and it will help the healing process.
Okay. I love that.
You know, there's no official video, but we just took the song and David just made a video just so we can all listen to it. I guess I want to just clarify, Tom, you wrote music and lyrics?
Yes.
And I want to also say you guys worked together. Was it Freaky Friday? Is that
Parent Trap? You want to say Parent Trap. Friday, Seth. Come on. It was Freaky Friday. And Tom, I feel like we did something before that too. Haven't we been working? I feel like I've been working with you my whole career.
Parent Trap.
We first met when you did a reading of Dave, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's right. That's right. There was a long ago in New York City, there was a reading of Dave, and I was lucky enough to be in that. And I was like, I had a teeny tiny part, and I always tell Tom, like, I would have done anything to be in that room. And that was the first time we ever worked together.
So this recording, where were you guys when it was recorded? How did you do it? In a studio?
Tom, you take it.
Yeah, we... And I have to just thank Sony, because from the beginning, Scott Farthing, who heard this idea and said, we're going to make this album with you, he said, we're going to be bringing people back in the studio, and musicians, singers. We tested, everyone felt safe. Can't say enough about the power station where we recorded. And I think Heidi was one of the very first sessions, and we just were all a pool of tears, just seeing one another and being in the same creative space again.
It was amazing. I looked at my Instagram post, and at the time we couldn't say what it was, but it was on February 24th. And when I got there, I remember my heart was pounding just because I had only interacted with my stepson, my husband, and my dog for many, many, many months. And I liked them very much. But this was obviously very cathartic. But immediately upon getting into Power Station, I totally burst into tears, and I got into my little cubby where I recorded, and I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe after spending so many months wondering how creativity was going to ever grow again, being in that studio, you know, setting up my lyrics in front of me and looking at live musicians. The track wasn't pre-recorded. We all sang live together, which is if you've recorded things, you know, singing with a track is great too, and I'll take it any day of the week. But singing with live musicians is a totally different thing because it's like an organic thing that lives and breathes together. And just, you know, being with all of those artists, it was almost too much to bear. I was feeling, you know, rainbows shooting out of my chest. And so what the track turned out to be was so raw and palpable. And, you know, the take that we got, and they did such a great job. Tom, you guys did such a great job editing, of course. And Jonathan Tunick did the orchestration, which is like magical. And It's just this perfect thing, you know, perfectly imperfect, which is my favorite thing. You can hear how raw it is in the recording.
Well, let's take a listen, and then Tom, well, hold on before I forget, because I probably will. How do people buy it?
I think it's available everywhere albums normally are available. Certainly Spotify, Apple Music, Amazon, and it's a beautiful packaging. The cover was done by a wonderful artist, Rachel Wolf Goldsmith. She created this, and it's just, it takes my breath away. So I actually wrote liner notes, and we all know for us album lovers that liner notes are you know, a treasured part of an album. So
absolutely,
I encourage everyone to not just own this digitally.
There you go. Okay, all right, we're gonna play the song.
Are the breaks? I should just accept it. So many mistakes, and yet I've always kept it together. But not now. Another run might be over before it's begun. So I'll only be known as this washed up wife in this sad and miserable joke of a life, if living is the word that does apply. Or maybe I should try and live before I die. Exist. I need to stand up and be counted, make it clear I won't be dismissed. I need to sing out. I must have a voice, though I know it could kill me. It isn't too hard of a choice. I need the reward for the years I gave up, my beauty restored as I drink from the cup. Tomorrow will be the dreams of today. The name on their lips is gonna be fame. I need them. I need them to see that I'm strong, to show them I know where I'm going instead of just going along, to turn this around, to be found before I disappear. I need them to see me and be glad. No one has a crystal ball, so I worry and wait. Better dead than too late, and to hell with them all. Here's to one more curtain call. I need them to see me. I need to feel something and fast, to be in this moment right now before the moment has passed. It's the cruelty of life. We're denied what we need the most. So before I'm a ghost, I need them to see me. I need them to see me.
Well, of course, Tom said that was the song for you because I was singing it. It's so beautiful.
It's perfect. It's a beautiful song for sure. I was very honored to sing it.
I had to check out the high note. It was a C sharp. So well played.
Tom usually makes me go a lot higher than that.
Yes, I was merciful this time, I guess.
I know.
Perfect for mother.
Heidi, thanks for joining us.
My pleasure. My pleasure.
Before I forget, Heidi, I know you probably can't comment, but I definitely heard a rumor. There's a giant job coming up for you. Can you tell us anything about the rumor I heard?
No. No, I cannot tell you anything about that. But you're not wrong.
Okay, well, that's something.
Can you say if it's TV or Broadway?
No, I'm going to get in trouble. No, I can't. Honestly, I can't say anything. I'll get in so much trouble. You're literally, I'm like flop sweating, like a perimenopausal flop sweating. Okay. So just know that you're not wrong, and that's all I'm going to say. Literally, I'm sweating.
Okay.
Okay.
And then we'll probably know fairly soon.
I hope, geez Louise, I hope so, for God's
okay.
sake.
Okay, there you go.
Okay.
All right, Heidi. Excited. All right, we'll see you next time.
Bye, guys.
Tom, we'll see you after the medical break, okay?
Okay.
And Pearl.
And Pearl, actually, and Pearl Sun. And so don't forget, starsinthehouse.com or text FUN2020 to 56512. And should we say that at the end, because we always say that people donate more when there's a song, a live song.
And there's going to be one at the end of this, and it's not going to be us singing.
It's not going to be us. So. With that in mind, let's bring on our friend, Chief Medical Correspondent of CBS News and Stars in the House, Dr. Jon LaPook.
Hi, guys.
Hi, Dr. LaPook.
Hi, Dr. LaPook. We have a story for you.
We have a story because we want to hear your thoughts, and we believe that it's very,
zeitgeisty.
Well, I mean, it's something that everyone is going through, and that is to ask questions. You know, the way that I asked the question when I had my colonoscopy, and I asked my anesthesiologist, had he been vaccinated, and he said no. So we're exit moving. What's that, Jon?
And it was exit stage left for you, and good for you.
Yes, it was. Yes, sure sir. Was. But so, you know, we're going to be moving down the street from you fairly soon.
Moving up west side. So I got these movers that were recommended. And after I did everything, made the deposit, I suddenly thought, wait a minute. So I called back and I was like, I know people wearing masks. I said, but are the movers vaccinated? And they're like, it's illegal to ask if someone's vaccinated. So we can't ask that. I was like, can I have vaccinated movers? Like, it's their personal life. So, of course, Julie, who's 20, she was like, it's not illegal. So I looked it up on Google, and it's like, it's perfectly legal for you to ask your employees whether they're vaccinated. And I called back and I said, it is legal. And it's like, well, it's a personal question. I go, it's not personal. I go, they're coming into my house. I go, they can stay home if they want, but they're entering my house. So it's not a private thing. It's actually public, and it's in my space. Are they vaccinated or not? And they're like, we don't. And I was like, cancel.
Luckily, we called a few places and we found one where the guy was actually very friendly. And turns out we know him after we were talking a little bit. That's a whole other thing that it's like, oh, I used to work on 72nd Street. I'm like, wait a minute, Felix from the gym? It was like, anyway, so thank you, Felix. But my point is, he was very much like, oh, he actually kind of laughed like, of course, everyone's vaccinated. He was the opposite. I'm so, like, thank you so much.
There's this myth that it's HIPAA. You can't ask if someone's vaccinated.
So tell us, clear the air here for people that are having similar situations of like all of that. Go.
So I'm so proud of you guys because you really have changed, haven't you? During this last year and a half, you've become empowered, which is always what we want of people, with information.
Right.
And whether it's popping off of the table where you're about to get a colonoscopy or asking your movers or asking anybody, I think it's within your right to do so. What the HIPAA thing, which has been misquoted by people in government.
Yes.
You know, HIPAA means that it's misinterpreted, but it's a healthcare, you know, portability act in privacy. I cannot, if I were your doctor, I cannot give your medical information to somebody else without your permission. That's a violation of HIPAA. It's your medical information. But I can ask you as somebody who's not somebody else's doctor, you can ask them if they're vaccinated. As far as I know, I mean, I'm not a lawyer, but you can ask them. They can say, that's rude. I don't want to tell you. And then that becomes a filter for somebody you don't want to be with.
Right.
So what I think
it still gives you an answer.
What's so beautiful about your question, it's almost like the canary in the coal mine question. The way they answered that told you whether you wanted to even deal with them, because exactly. Whether it was that they were going to be rude to you about that or they were going to break your furniture. I mean, you want somebody whose brain is wired in such a way that they understand that during a pandemic, it is absolutely reasonable to tell people whether or not you are vaccinated.
And I said, a simple Google, I said, for you to quote me, it's illegal. And I said, when I did a 2-second Google search to find out it's not illegal, I was like, forget it, cancel, you're liars. I mean,
you did cancel, didn't you?
I did cancel. I wrote a long letter. I took a screenshot of an article. I said, as you see here, it is not illegal. I mean, I gave a link. I know I did it all. I canceled.
Unfortunately, I'm sure they're not going to answer, and people are just going to hire them and not necessarily ask. And you know,
I would say to people, you know, look, I am hearing more and more breakthrough cases all the time. We know that the protection is going down for asymptomatic or mild or moderate. Jury's out on severe, but clearly it's less protective as time goes past 6 months. For just getting infected, period. And I got to be honest, guys, because I want to tell you what I'm hearing. I heard another every day I hear stories. Today I heard a story about three people who were in a house upstate and they were riding together. Three friends trust each other. One of them, you know, today or was it yesterday, tested positive, and she's pretty sure the exposure was from an outdoor wedding. Now, I'm hearing this more and more about the outdoor wedding thing. And I think, you know, because we first heard about it in Houston, right, where the two people from India who had breakthrough infections, even though they were vaccinated, they went to an outdoor wedding in Houston. They infected five other people who were vaccinated. So it depends on, like, use your head. You know, if you're right next to somebody, like right next to them, and you're hugging them and, hi, how are you? Oh, my God, it was great. And you're in their face. It's not that different from being indoors with that person. I mean, it's not enough dilution from the outdoors. If you're 8 feet away from them, that's a whole other matter. So I just think people need to be empowered. Today, you know, I took an Uber today. Every time I get into a cab, I ask, first thing I do is I look in, are they wearing a mask? If they are not wearing a mask and they're going to put it on because I'm there, I don't get in.
Right.
Because they've been breathing.
Exactly.
Infected air in there. I don't want to get in. All right. That's the first thing. The second thing is they have a mask. I get in. Are you vaccinated? I'm asking that as I'm rolling down the windows. I guess people don't roll down the windows anymore, but anyway, bring down the windows. And then I asked them if they could put their windows down in the front. And I did that twice today. And then I explained to them, this makes it safer for you. You should want it down. And then I'm a doctor and, you know, it can be in the air. This makes it safer. And both of the people, both of the drivers appeared to be very appreciative of that. And then, you know, because Delta is just, it's just much more contagious. It just is.
Okay. Well, I'm sorry, Dr. Book, it's the window next to the driver and the opposite.
Well, if you can get all four,
that's ideal.
But when they did this study, this very clever study about, you know, the aerodynamics of it, you know, front left, back right, or front right, back left. It's that cross ventilation. But if you can get all four, all the better. So
go ahead.
No, I was just going to say for all the viewers out there, do not be intimidated to ask your waiter if they're vaccinated. When you call up a restaurant, if you're going to eat outdoors, are the waiters masked? Mm-hmm. Are they vaccinated? Before you go into it, I think that's something that we need to ask. And by the way, peer pressure is not such a bad thing on businesses to have them go ahead and, you know, mandate where it's appropriate, masks and vaccination for people who can get vaccinated.
You know, John, along those lines, and I would say as far as the peer pressure is concerned, there was a viewer the other day, and I didn't put the comment up, and she said that she had tickets. I don't know what the city is, but she had tickets to Hamilton, and she was getting a refund and turning them in because they were not requiring the audience members to be vaccinated. And we know performance venues around the country that aren't asking the performers to show proof of vaccination are the audience. And I think that it's incumbent upon people all over the country, not in New York, not in LA, everywhere, mm-hmm. to say, I'm not going to buy tickets to your venue. I know this may sound almost like contradictory to why we're here to support the performing arts, but we also have to support everyone's safety and health. That you should say, I'm only going to buy a ticket to your performance venue.
Yeah, let me say something. Yeah, I just got a gig in Ohio, and I'm getting double talk from the theater saying, you know, we're following all government protocols. And I was like, it's not enough. I said, it can't just be that. It's got to be vaccinations and masks. I'm not interested in you name dropping protocols, because what are their protocols? Wiping down surfaces?
Yeah, which is, you know, a lot of that is, what's it called? COVID theater, you know, that, you know, going through the, you know, yes, you want to wash your hands, fine. You don't have to wash down every surface in the place, but it's in the air, folks. Ventilation, filtration. I think people have to get it in their head about MERV 13. I'm sorry, but, you know, MERV 13 and HEPA filters and how much clean air, how many air exchanges per hour in a room. They're saying 4 to 6 at least. The more, the merrier. You know, the airplanes have a lot more than that. Yeah, I think people have to get in they're the devil's in the details on this. And I love the fact that you guys, I know you guys were talking to me earlier about Seth's show, that you're taking it seriously. You're talking to aerosol scientists. You're talking to, you know, people who can look at your specific place and say, yes, the ventilation and filtration works here. Now what are the other layers? We're going to have people vaccinated. We're going to make sure they have masks. And by the way, the better the masks, I think these days I personally am walking around with an N95 that's very comfortable. I have one KN95, KF94s. I think just the aerosol scientists are more and more saying the plain cloth mask alone probably is not good enough given Delta. So if you have, if you can't get one of those better masks, surgical mask plus on top of that a double ply, because that gets down the sides of that surgical mask, right. It's not puffed out, and that's pretty good. It's not as good as the N95, but I think we got to up our masking game, do everything that you guys were talking about, and then also testing. I'm such a huge believer in this. We have to do more home testing, especially as the schools start.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, this is good.
Right. All right. Thank you, Dr.
I'm going to leave you with a good note. I taught your medical students today at NYU Langone Health, where I'm a professor of medicine, for the Empathy Project, you know, my project, which is to use Hollywood quality short films to teach clinicians in training to be more empathetic, sensitive, and competent, to empower patients to demand it. And we showed them a movie we've been working on for a year and a half, animated movie about implicit bias and racism in medicine. And these kids were fantastic. I am so hopeful for the future of medicine. They were great. Wow. They got it. They were on it. They were respectful. It was great. We were uncoiled. We were all listening. So I think the next generation doctor is going to be a good one.
Oh, congrats. Oh,
that's exciting. Bravo.
All right, John. We'll see you next time.
See you next time.
Bye. Okay, bye. All right, let's bring... Yes, sir.
Julia, there's no shortage of N95s masks. Dr. LaPook said that last night. She's asking there's a shortage.
Should we them?
He said there's not a shortage anymore, so you should get them.
All right, so let's bring back on Tom Kitt. Tom?
Hi, Tom.
Tom, what is your thought on that? Because you've got shows that are all over the place. Have you had to ask those difficult questions? Your cast or whoever?
I think we're all asking those questions, and it's what you both were talking about just now. You know, hopefully things that we think should just be common sense and, the best protocols to keep everyone safe, that should be in place and there shouldn't be a question about it. And especially if the performers are going to go on stage and not have masks on, there has to be a buy-in from the audience to say that we are going to mask and be vaccinated. Whatever the safest way to keep everyone, you know, healthy, everyone has to buy into that. They're just, you know, obviously, just as we're being talked, there's still a risk. I mean, we're still 18 months into this, having these same conversations. And we're not, you know, when everyone was like, we're done, it's over. I've been masking the entire time. And maybe that's just from being in New York City the whole time.
Right.
But we've just always been on the defensive with this. We've never been in front of it. So I feel like the least we can do is ask everyone to be as responsible and as safe as possible for everybody.
Well said. Okay, let's bring on Pearl. Pearl Sun. Hi, Pearl.
Hi.
Pearl, this is the first of your two appearances this week on Stars in the House.
I'm honored. I can't believe it. I was about to message you and say, should I be on twice in 1 week? I don't know.
Yeah.
Wait, by the way, I think we have the same poster, don't we, James? Isn't that the subway one? What is it? Is that a subway?
It's a map of the city.
It's very similar, Seth, but I don't think it's exactly it.
Is it in the hallway?
No, it's in the bathroom.
Oh, it's so cool. I love it. I got it on 73rd Street in Columbus. So how did – who hooked up with whom? Because I know, Pearl, you did Next to Normal, so I'm sure you know Tom from that. Who called who and what happened?
Oh, boy. Tom called me, and he called me. He said, so I have a proposition for you. And I said, what? And he basically, as he had mentioned earlier, said, so I've been working through this period and I was struggling with creativity and I thought this was an important time to create new work and have something to say and collaborate with friends. And he said, here's the deal. I give you a week. And you're to write either free form or a poem or themes, some words, whatever comes to you, whatever's in your heart that you would like to talk about. And then I will compose a song based on what you've sent me. And then we will go into the studio and record it.
I love that you gave a deadline. Someone's really smart there, and he knows artists very well.
No, I asked him. He did not give me a deadline, and then I said, what's the deadline?
Oh, okay.
That's that smart. Was my first.
I thought that you said a week would be great, but take your time.
Exactly.
He
said a week would be great, and I was like, okay. Because inside I was like, I'm not a writer. What am I going to do? And, but obviously there's been a lot on my mind through this whole period. And I know that, Tom has been connecting with me online and he's witnessed stuff that is meaningful to me that I post about on social media. And the timing of it was crazy because I believe he had reached out to me on a Friday. So he gave me a week deadline. And the following Tuesday night were the Atlanta spa shootings. And I had already thought to myself that what I did want to talk about was the Asian hate crime situation. And so when the spa shootings happened, I was overwhelmed and devastated. My mother is a manicurist, an immigrant. Yeah. So it hit way too close to home for me. And Wednesday morning, he called and he just called to check in. He said, Pearl. He said, how are you feeling? And I just lost it. And I started crying. And I said, I'm not great. I'm not good. And he said, I know that this is a really challenging moment and period. But if you can if you have any sort of space at all to jot down how you're feeling right now. And I said, I was actually thinking to do that. And I got off the phone with him and wrote for 30 minutes straight. And that's what I sent him was 30 minutes. It was a page long. And I sent it over to him. And then I don't know, about 5-10 minutes later, I thought, wait a second, there's something else I want to send you. So I sent him a voice memo, which is the explanation. I said, I don't know why this came to me, but I wanted to tell you how to say in Mandarin Chinese the word to be careful. And to be careful is xiaoxing, and the literal translation is small heart. So in order to be careful, you have to keep your heart small. And I think that thematically, it just felt correct and right. And that our community and immigrants in general, they have this idea that once they enter this country, they're to put their heads down, make as little noise as possible, assimilate, and keep yourself small, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that that's why, partially why we are where we are right now and why we are having these issues, because, we're not known to make noise. were not known, so that if we are to be bullied, if we are to be mishandled, that we will not stand up and speak out against these atrocities that are happening. So I felt like that was needed to be addressed.
So when did you get the song from Tom?
So I sent him the statement on Wednesday afternoon, and by Thursday evening, he said, "Hey, I want to play you what I have so far." And he played me 3/4 of the song. That was Thursday afternoon. And by Friday morning, he had the entire song finished.
Wow.
And, you know, to have Tom call me on the phone on Thursday, the next day, playing, sitting at his piano, just playing it to me over the phone with him singing along what he had written so far, I just was devastated. And I couldn't believe, he just put everything together. He managed to fit in "To Be Careful" in Mandarin into the song, and he just fit it all in, and it's a dream. I can't believe it. And, you know, Tom and I have worked together so much. I mean, I did Next to Normal, and then I did If Then with him, and then I did 3 readings of other shows with him. So it's just, but to collaborate in this way, we've never had this opportunity, and such a generous collaborator. And it's been a dream, Tom.
Thank you.
Tom, I have a question just creatively. So if you had 3/4 of the song completed that next day, did playing it for Pearl and getting her feedback or her reaction, did that help get you to the finish line, or like did that play into it, or was it just more about encouragement because it really touched her? I'm just curious how that plays out for you.
Yeah, it's all of that. I mean, certainly first and foremost to make sure that it's in the right direction. And because she used the word devastating, and what she sent was devastating and beautiful and hopeful and filled with fight and inspiration, and to get something that's just already a work of art and now take that a step further into a song. I just wanted to say, how do you feel about this and how I've said it? Yeah. And then I don't remember specifically, but I do feel like there was great feedback that helped me, that spurred me on. It's one of those bridges in the song that continues to develop. And the words in the song, they're just so important. And there's a word that we had used, and then with Pearl's guidance, we decided not to use. And it's more powerful that way. It's really towards the end. There's a stoppage in the song, and you'll know what the word would have been if Pearl had sang it. So all things, it was, you know, again, to make sure it was on the right track, and also got great feedback from her as well.
Well, on that note, let's play it right now.
The world is on fire, and there is no sign of rain. Beaten and terrorized, resilience is dwarfed by pain. It seems that we're always escaping from somewhere, and if that's so, will we ever be home? Othered and bullied, mastering the stiff upper lip, they make us apply, then deny us our membership. Move out of the way, go back to your country. I thought this was my country. Shell-shing, small heart, be careful, live cautiously. These are the words that my mother ingrained in me. Snow, you must sweep your own snow. just worry about you and sweep your own snow. It keeps getting worse, and there is no end in sight. It's yet one more war that we never wanted to fight. We came here in search of a life, a future, with a promise that is America. Shell-shing smart, be careful, live cautiously. But what if that isn't the person I want to be? Sweep your own snow. You must sweep your own snow. You can't be consumed by the struggle. Your own snow. The victims of misogyny, now sprinkled with white supremacy. Sadly, the perfect recipe for turning us into the enemy.
Gosh, it's beautiful.
And P.S. I don't know if you read reviews, but the comments on the side are over the top, mm-hmm. like obsessed with you.
Oh, someone, I haven't seen them. I'm sorry. I need to go.
Compared your phrasing to a bow on a string.
Oh, thank you. Thank you all. And Tom, I think Seth will get a kick out of this. Your choice of key choice. Why did you choose the key that it's in?
Oh, by the way, I already tested it. It was a D that you belted. I was so impressed. But continue. I literally went to the piano.
You just sit down and I don't know. I just started playing in that key. Don't you find that, Seth? Sometimes you just sit down and there's in your mind just sort of brings
well,
you to.
You had told me it was an next to normal connection.
Oh, yes. Well, the chords, though. That's right. So the fact that we had done Next to Normal together, I that's right. I did bring that into it. Thank you for
that. I love that. Has your mom heard it and what's her reaction been?
She said that she was proud of me. Okay, and she said, thank you so much. So that was a lot.
I love the generational.
That's everything.
List. I've got to take, man, our dog just had surgery and she's going crazy. Let me take
So you go do that. Tom. So Tom, you're going to close the show for us, right? What are you going to do?
I'm going to play a song from the album live.
I love it. All right. Yay! Hold on. There we go. Thank you, David. All right.
So
I'm going to set it up and David will mute us. So it'll be all on you.
Sure. So this is another song actually that was written prior to beginning this project. It's a song called Fly Away that I wrote, I would say back in the late 90s. Another song that I was just listening to it one day and I just felt like it really spoke to this moment and was very personal to me. And on the album, my son, Michael, I should say all three of my children are on this album. Michael sings on Fly Away, Julia sings on This Too Shall Pass. And my youngest, Charlie, has the hidden track. So you have to listen.
Oh, I love that.
Hear Elizabeth's song, Breathe, the last song on the album. You get a question, actually, that Charlie asked me early on in the pandemic. And it kind of broke my heart. And I just felt like it would be the perfect period on the end of the sentence. So anyway, this is Fly Away. And I sing it on the album. So hence, I'm singing it now. I've waited my whole life for a change to arrive, to bring me the hope that I need, to keep me alive. So let the sky just open up and let it swallow me whole. Let the rebirth begin in my soul. Fly away, and my love will return. Fly away, or I'll crash and I'll burn. Fly away, let it carry me home. Over mountains and trees. Fly away with my back to the breeze. I'm tired all the time. I can't even stand. I try to supply in this world. There is no demand. I thought of it all. I could just disappear. But now my Savior is here. Oh, fly away, and my love will return. Fly away, or I'll crash and I'll burn. Fly away, let it carry me home. Over mountains and trees. Fly away, and I'm going home. Yeah, home. And if it looks okay, then I just might stay. Hey, fly away, and my love will return. Fly away, or I'll crash and I'll burn. Fly away, let it carry me home. Over mountains and trees. Fly away, with my back to the breeze.
Tom.
The whole album is beautiful and cathartic. It's healing.
It's a time capsule of this 18 months and, you know, all the artists that have that Tom drew in. And, you know, it's a testament to Tom to, like, look at him. He's just, as Heidi said, when Tom calls, you say yes. You just don't even, what is it you need, Tom? Yes, yes.
You know, it's something that I was unrecognizable to my kids early on, you know, and this was something, thank you for using those words about healing and, you know, capturing this time, because it's a way for me to say what you're living through. It's going to have meaning. It's going to teach you lessons. And first and foremost, your dad has to show you that he's learning those lessons and he's finding his resiliency and he's creating and speaking to this moment. So thank you for saying that.
Oh, it's true. Hey, before we go, Tom, could you read the donation that's in there's one of the donations that came in. Can you read it? It's in the private chat.
I'm going to put on my glasses.
Go for it. I'll put on my glasses, Tom.
That's what happens.
Yes.
So where do I find it?
It's in the private chat.
There's two here. There's one.
Oh, yeah. The one that David sent.
Okay. While sad, we're back in lockdown in New Zealand. One arriving Delta case broke into 200 community cases within a week. It is great to ease the concern by watching Stars in the House. Perfect episode today with Heidi, who I saw in New York with the cast of Something Rotten, and Tom Kidd, who gave us If Then, which I also saw in New York, and by a community theater in New Zealand. I'll cheers a glass of Sarah's and Saab to all your hard work, and knowing that my vaccination date is now less than a week. Aaron R., $25.
Wow. Thank you, Aaron. From New Zealand. All right, Tom, thank you so much for creating this and for joining us tonight. All right, you're taking off your glasses. Mine. Seth got loudmouth bagel. He's back. They're both back to say goodbye. And Pearl, I'll see you later on in the week.
Friday.
Yes.
Let's play some games.
Yes. I might be an emotional mess because only a few hours earlier I would have dropped off Julie. So I'm just saying, Carl, I may need you virtually for a shoulder to cry on.
I mean, hey, parent to parent, we got this.
Okay. All right.
I'm very excited to see you back in New York. Have a good trip and safe travels back here.
Thanks, Tom. All right. Good night, everyone. And reflect. Go to everywhere music is sold and available. Right, Tom?
And thank you all for being here tonight.
That's correct. Yes. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Bye.
Yay.